meant for an adult audience. LoveLine may contain sexually oriented content. Listener discretion is advised. Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
LoveLine, coast to coast.
Hey, everybody. LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That's Dr. Drew over there.
Are we actually going on the radio here? We have to stop talking about your car?
Yeah. Phone number 1-800-LOVE-191. Dr. Drew, board certified physician, addiction medicine specialist. All right. Donna D'Errico and Nikki Sixx are going to be in here, theoretically, very soon. Donna, you know, from Baywatch, and of course, Baywatch. Oh, yes, BattleBots. Sabrina the Teenage Witch. Oh, yeah, BattleBots. I love that BattleBots. I forgot she was on that.
Mm-hmm.
They always stick chicks on BattleBots, and you can always tell they just have absolutely zero interest in it. But they have to act like they're interested in it. So, they interview the guys after the match.
Yeah.
It'll be like Ziggo against Vlad the Impaler. But the chicks aren't interested at all. So they go, Vlad, you had a tough battle against...
that other guy.
The other one. Yeah, and then they go, yeah, I did, Donna. And they go, okay. Back to you. They're just... I don't blame them. It would be as if... they stuck me because they needed some hot male ass on some home decorating channel.
At the end of the runway at the Paris fashion event?
No, yeah. It's as if there was a show that was geared exclusively for women.
Yeah.
Had to do with cuticles
and
nails.
You were doing the interviews.
And someone said they needed a dude there.
Well, that's a man show, you bet, right there.
Yeah, so they've never had it. Carmen Electra does it now, I think. Yeah. Or did they get rid of her? The point is,
last I thought she was doing
they've
it.
Never been interested, yeah. And they've never cared, and rightfully so. But they just can't even pretend. Maybe they're not paying them enough to pretend. So anyway, Donna will be in here, and always good to see Donna D'Errico and Nikki Sixx as well.
Just
here
one,
they
man.
Are. Hey. Well, hi, speak of the devils. I believe... I was going to... Sometimes I try to jar my brain into getting an answer correct.
Yeah.
So I go, I believe the last time we saw you, and my brain, I'm going,
stop.
Come on, spit something good out. But I don't know when it was. It's been a while, right?
It's been a couple of years.
Yeah.
Yes, they're a lovely couple. Donna, I had was in here years ago, was doing some drinking and doing some partying, and then cleaned herself up and became a good mama, right?
Yes.
Yes.
And I was a good mom then, too, but...
I don't think you were a mom then.
Yeah, I was.
Yeah, yeah.
You were?
Yeah.
Oh, I didn't know that.
Yeah.
Do you have a couple of kids?
I have two now that I've had, and then... but we have five altogether.
Boom.
Whoa.
Two. Yeah. Five all out of you?
No. Two out of me. The last one was last year. She's 15 months now.
Mm.
And I had one before. Nikki had three before.
Yeah.
Wow.
She and got now, me fixed.
Yeah, he's neutered, so there's
nice.
No more.
I'm loving it.
How was that? Was that painful?
It sucked, dude.
You know,
it
did? I think you were talking about that
stupid
last
question,
time
though,
we were
right?
here. You were asking a lot of questions about that.
But yeah. No, I, you know.
Yeah, that's right, you were.
It's been on my mind.
Yeah, Drew and everyone always says it's painful, but it's worth it for the first time, you know, when you make your comeback.
So to speak.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Is that true?
Or get it back, as it were.
It's kind of degrading.
Yeah,
you know,
the whole experience.
Well, I mean,
you
mean, like I got laid out there,
mm-hmm.
draped.
You've done it?
No, I've been involved in it.
Okay,
I've been on the handling.
So. Okay, yeah, you get draped, and then you know you're thinking you're gonna get some kind of star treatment here, right?
Right.
Nurse Ratchet walks in. She looks down at your whatever it is, and just goes, "Yep, looks like you're ready." And you're thinking, you know, she has something else to say, like,
"Yeah,
wow." Anything, you know, and then comes that big long needle, and that's the part that's
the big. You get the big long needle in the in the scrotum and the abdomen. Where do you get it?
Scrotum.
Right in the scrotum. Really?
All through that area.
Do they have to shave things for this?
Did they shave it?
I was already shaved.
Yeah.
Oh, okay. Yeah, smooth. See? I knew it would pay dividends one day. But they pretty much shave your crotch for everything, right? You go
yeah,
for
when,
like a Botox injection for your eyes and they shave your nuts,
when you had
right?
that hand surgery?
Shave the nuts.
Yeah.
What?
No. But they did take my underpants, which I still object to, by the way.
Oh.
All right.
I had to come from across the street to settle the crowd down.
Well, I told them, look, you're doing... You're doing hand surgery on me. I'm sprawled out. They actually strap your arm to a 6-foot sandwich board because they don't. They, in a
That's
sort of
like
Jesus.
When like in when you have a C-section, they do that with both.
They strap
both
your
arms. Yeah.
Yeah, it's like so. If you go like Jesus went. And I thought, and they're like, we're gonna need your underpants. And I'm like, could my balls get any further away from the action? Please let me have my dignity. Like, it's important that we have your underpants. I was like, how crucial is it to this procedure that you guys confiscate my underpants?
You know they're on eBay now.
Now there's a crowd gathering now, right? And he's yelling at everybody. You know,
why do you guys need my underpants?
Opinions from the security guard, other patients in the waiting room. Really, should I be giving my underpants up? They call me, page me across the
I told them,
to come
they,
over there.
You know what they said? They said there's an elastic in your underpants and they could catch on fire with some sort of static shock thing. I said, you know what? I said, I know
think you got played, dude.
That's a beautiful line of BS. Show me the waiver, and I'll sign it, and I'll take my chances and one in the kabillion chance my nuts catch on fire from static shock. Well, look, I'd give them the underpants if they didn't give you the robe that ties in back. You're sedated. You got a cast on your hand. It's one of those bad smock things that tie in back. You can never get it right, and you just walk around with your ass hanging out.
And it kind of feels good, but it kind of feels bad.
Yeah. Well, in Adam's
case.
And
you didn't have the benefit of the underpants on.
No, no. My case, it's bad for everybody. Everybody in there. Yeah, I got a lot of hair on my ass.
Oh, boy.
Thank
bad.
You, Drew.
Oh, yeah.
Donna,
I didn't need to think about that.
Donna, what are we plugging tonight here, baby?
Oh, well, JVC has joined up with Urban Decay Makeup Cosmetics.
Yes.
To make the first line of car stereos that are geared towards women.
And how does that work? What would make it different?
Well, they're colored. The two that are out now are in two of the Urban Decay eyeshadow colors. It's like a purple and a green. Hmm. They're not like a fuzzy pink thing or anything frou-frou, but they're a little softer. They have color, and the knobs on there are
boobs.
Like, the actual the volume control.
That'd be for lesbians.
Yeah.
It's for, like, if you have long nails, it's easy to use. There's a little tiny remote control.
Really? There's hair around the cassette slot?
No hair, no.
Oh, cassettes, come on. What year is this?
But it's like, you know.
CD wouldn't have worked right for the joke, I don't think.
It wouldn't have.
Yeah, I'm sorry.
You know
what?
Basically, it's like in electronic stores.
Mm-hmm.
I think women have always been kind of out of place.
Yeah.
And I think you rarely see a woman go into a car stereo shop, shopping for a car stereo. Because there's a wall of just black-faced car stereo units that all look identical to me.
Yeah, they got that Israeli guy who works there who wants to know what's the most you can possibly spend. And you go, Izzy, I can go $250. That's as much as I can spend for a tape deck. And he goes, oh, that is too bad. We have a beautiful unit here. It's only $325. Man, that is marked down. But if you want to step up.
For the next 2 days.
I have this one at home. I like that one, too.
It's in my car.
Which now I think to myself, wait a minute.
At home?
I'm a cable TV guy, and you're selling stereos. So that doesn't cut it anymore. I want a better one than you have at home. You still live at home with your mom. So this is made for women. And it doesn't smell like anything, but it's got the coloring, it's got the knobs. It's easy to figure out.
It's easy to figure out.
Is the volume the knob? Because that's what I like.
I think it's marketed to women is what JVC is trying to get across.
It is really marketed. It is.
Remote control.
Got a remote?
It has a remote control, credit card remote control. And like Nikki's saying, it's like, you know, it's marketed to women, and so when a woman goes in a car stereo shop, she'll see, oh, these are geared for me, instead of looking at 50 other units and being treated like she's stupid or lost.
They need a chick in the store selling to chicks. That's what they need to do.
I agree.
They do?
Yeah.
They do?
I haven't seen that.
Ironically, it's Good Guys that has the one chick working there.
There are lesbians there.
All right. Let's take ourselves some calls. You know what the worst is? Let me tell you about the worst in car stereo design. Somebody decided like 11 years ago that the knob was outdated and we needed to have the sort of bar that controlled the volume. But you can never quite figure out where you're at with that bar. Like, you can't improve on the knob as far as stereo. Like, whenever you ride in a limousine, the stereo's above your head,
right,
and there's no knob. and you're pushing buttons up there, but you can't figure out which one is the goddamn
That's
volume.
True. It's like you want it simple. There's
yes,
the knob.
I want knobs. I want the knob to turn it on and off, and then I want it to go up to 10 and then come back down to 1. And that is it. And the one above of your head, the one above the head in the limo has the face that pops off. And I'll always pop the face off and onto my lap 2 or 3 times before I find
the power,
the volume,
yeah, the
volume
power.
Or the power.
Yeah. Right.
What is that?
I don't know. And different things come up on the screen as you push buttons.
Yeah, I mean,
fader,
Drew, this has happened to you more than once, right? And here's the other problem, too. It's dark in the limo, and you're almost always loaded. So it's like...
Those things are hard to figure
out. You can drive from Sherman Oaks to LAX, and you haven't figured out the stereo yet.
Mm. And you get sick, too, right? Looking up like...
yeah.
Car
You're like, you just want to turn it
safe.
Up, and you've yeah. changed the channel 3 times.
It should be the color of eyeshadow, and it should have a knob.
That's
and a remote control.
And a remote. That's
and these
right.
faces do pop off, too.
And doesn't interfere with your long fingernails.
That's right.
Thank
yes,
you.
That's right. Aaron?
Yeah?
You're 18?
This What's is up? In honor of Nikki. Go ahead.
Dr. Drew, I have a question for you.
Yeah.
Okay, I'm 18 years old, and when I was born with undescended testicle.
Mm-hmm.
It was a right testicle. Mm-hmm. So when I was 6, they tried to pull it down.
They just forgot, took it out.
Oh, well, no, they took it, they pulled it down, they wrapped it in a silicone sack, which I guess back then was the big thing. So
okay.
They went back into when I was 12, and they were going to pull it down more, but the silicone had disintegrated.
Okay.
And turned the thing dead.
All right.
So they took it out, and they put an FDA-approved prosthesis in.
All right.
They put a large in.
So okay.
They shouldn't have, and I got a staph infection. They took it out.
Wow.
It dimpled.
What? How did
they shouldn't have put a large in, or they shouldn't have put anything in?
They shouldn't have put a large in.
This is a lot of complication for a pretty simple and common situation.
I got a staph infection, and I was in the hospital for 11 days.
Oh, my God.
Why shouldn't they have put a large in?
Because I was 12.
But it didn't grow in. Grow
and my scrotum was only used
grow
to
into
one
it.
Testicle. My scrotum was only used to one
but,
testicle.
But I think the idea is that you grow into it, so you don't have to replace it as you get older. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
so,
but this one just, the hole they slipped it into never even closed.
Yeah, but this has more to do with the infection.
But they
should have
gone
else.
With the large.
Yeah, forget that. It got Idiot. Infected and it had an unusual complication for simple procedure, so that's why.
And furthermore, right now they don't have any FDA-approved prosthesis on the market. They're doing a study, and it's like I'm not going to name the company that's doing it, but it's a silicone prosthesis, and I'm trying to figure out, you know, the packet they gave me didn't quite, you know, inform me well enough, and I don't get to see the doctor as often as I would like to ask him the question, so I'm trying to figure out what kind of complications. I mean,
well, there's always concern about putting silicone inside people's bodies. There's always been,
there is
well there has been this,
yeah,
this controversy
Adam,
around it.
But yeah, but they didn't find anything
I understand.
Too bad with that.
I understand, and that's why it's coming. These things are coming back onto the market. But I've seen like
How about glass.
I've seen like not glass, but acrylic kind of.
What's
kind
wrong
of,
with glass?
Well, glass breaks.
So if I
well,
can hit the ball
safety
with...
glass. Hold on a second.
There's sort of that kind of thing out there.
Yeah,
but I've had patients that have those.
Well,
and
what,
they're
what
not.
About, like,
what is the silicone thing that was put in?
That's something a fake testy. Something that felt like a testy.
Because
his was not ascended, his got removed.
Well, wait a minute. Oh. Should it have some give?
Yeah, it should be like...
Testy has a little give.
Yeah, they can manufacture it to feel like a testy, but the hard ones really are not cosmetically quite right.
Well, how much feel do you need in your actual ball?
How much symmetry do you need in something as beautiful as a testy anyway?
Yeah.
We're not even talking about testy, we're talking about...
It's a mess down there.
Yeah.
It really is. It's Donna, it's a horribly ugly part of a male, is it not?
Yeah, it is. It's
women could do without it, right?
ABC gum.
But
yeah.
but having one is just half the misery, right? It's not.
Well, I don't think you want to look different than other people.
Yeah, you want to be symmetrical down there.
But on the other hand, they could just.
Who's going to see?
You could use one of those little Easter eggs.
Chick, I guess.
Just cut, yeah. Just take them both out.
It's just the male ego thing. Oh, my God, I only have one ball.
Right, right.
What if you have none?
Which
That'd
happens.
Be kind of weird.
Which
then
happens.
You'd, then you'd be really cool.
Yeah, I think women would prefer men had none.
Yeah.
Down
the porno
there.
Guys have none.
Yeah, what happens to
that? Why is that? Why is that?
It's an evolution
thing. It's something to do with the
something
streamlining.
Is up with that.
Something's
they're
up
weird.
With that. Like right before they're going to, you know, do it, it's like.
Oh, well, that's normal. That's what most people do. The cremasteric response pulls them up. Actually, some people they go up actually into the abdomen during all
really?
That.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah. I wish I should be able to train mine to do that. They don't do that.
Yeah.
I try to get them up there. They get
Yours
stuck in the down
We need to get a mirror happening.
They must keep it really cold in the Porn studio.
Well, you don't know. I mean,
porn studios.
Nikki, your balls may do that as well.
They might. I've never seen. I need to get one of those mirrors.
They do.
How do you know?
Word on the street.
We've had children.
Michelle?
Yes.
You're 27?
Yes.
What's up?
Well, my deal is I just got out of a relationship again. And basically, well, it's like this. I'm going to be a bridesmaid again this year for another friend. And I don't understand why is it that everyone else is having long relationships and that lead to marriage and this sort of thing. And I don't.
Well, you help us. Tell us what's been happening to you.
She sounds like a pain in the ass.
How old are you?
27.
I'm ready to break up with her already.
You're fat. How many
relationships? Please.
What's your longest relationship?
My longest relationship was 2 years.
And, okay, so you're quite capable of
that's pretty long.
Sustained intimacy. And why do they end usually?
I leave quite a bit. This last time I was left, it was only a 3-month relationship. And I haven't actually had a long-term relationship in maybe 4 years.
Why do I feel completely empty, confused? Like, I can't get anything about what it is that's going on here. Do you choose the wrong guys? Are the relationships dysfunctional or chaotic? Are they unavailable guys? Do you freak out and sabotage these relationships? Do you push guys away? I mean, what's the vibe on these relationships?
I think unavailable would be.
So you go for unavailable guys?
Somewhat, yeah.
Somewhat.
All right.
Well,
more like guys who they aren't looking for something that would lead to marriage.
Thus, they
and
are.
I know that, and I think that I stick in there and try and make that.
Right. Thus, they're unavailable in the way you need them to be.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Unavailable guys.
How's the rest of your life going?
It's going okay. I'm not living in a place that I want to be, but I'm planning on moving. And
all right, baby. Listen, don't kill yourself.
Well,
it's
first of
no
all,
big deal.
Describe this last guy. What did he do for a living? What happened? What was the relationship like?
Okay. Well, let's see. Yeah. He was a musician. Mm-hmm. And he...
That's your first problem.
I was going to say that.
Strike one.
Don't ever... Forget that.
He moved out what?
He moved out of state.
Okay.
All right.
I feel empty.
I know. I feel empty except for I have gas. Other than that, I'm empty. Michelle, you left us all empty.
Did you have anything? I'll give you a book.
I'll give her a book.
Dreams of Love and Fateful Encounters.
I'm sorry, what was the title again?
Dreams of Love and Fateful Encounters.
Okay.
Go read that book.
Thank you very
much.
Okay,
all right.
All right, good times there, baby.
All right, yeah,
and look, listen, all you ladies, get off your high horse and find yourself a nice slob of a man who's desperate.
With a
plenty of guys out there who are very dedicated. Women aren't interested in these guys, unfortunately for these guys, but there's lots of these guys, and they would love to settle down, start a family, and dedicate themselves to one woman. Women aren't interested in these guys. And you know what? They're not even really bad-looking guys, and there's nothing wrong with them except for they're a little too easy,
boring.
And they're boring, and they're just... It's the sort of feeling like, look, they're always going to be there. Let's go out and see what we can get.
Find something better.
If we can't get anything, we can come back and get these guys. There's a new crop of them coming in every year. And women are generally right with that, but you can't... those guys are always there.
Yeah.
But you cannot complain that there are no guys who will settle down or who will be devoted, dedicated, or will treat you right. They're out there. They're just those guys.
They're boring.
Yeah. Thank you. All right.
Boring.
Phoebe?
Yeah?
You're 18?
Yeah.
What's up?
I have a question for Dr. Drew.
Mm-hmm.
I've been taking orthotricycline for about 2 weeks now.
Mm-hmm.
And I've been experiencing some unusual side effects, and I'm not sure if they're side effects from orthotricycline or not.
What are they?
Like, I've been really dizzy and sweating a lot. I've shortness of breath and, like, nausea spells. I've been having nausea in and out.
Any leg swelling?
No.
Any abdominal pain?
Yeah, just yesterday and today, actually, I've been having, like, sharp stabbing pains in my lower right.
Well, you really need to call the doctor that prescribed these things. There are occasionally, and this is, I'm really reaching just because I don't know you and I'm just trying to think of any potential serious thing this could be. You can get exacerbation of migraines that can lead to strokes. You can get blood clots in your legs that can cause emboli of the lung or clots in the veins of the abdomen, the intestines. These are real rare things that if you had some genetic predisposition to this, you could get. So you got to just talk to your doctor about it. Make sure it's just basic routine kinds of side effects.
Yeah, the doctor prescribed the medication. Unfortunately, my medical insurance ran out. So when I called back, they told me that since my medical insurance called back, that I didn't have any reason to talk to him.
Well, I think that's unethical and irresponsible because he is still the prescribing physician. You may not be able to see him. I understand that. But I think he owes you a couple minutes. At least talk to a nurse there at the office. Somebody. Get the message to him that you're having these symptoms.
What kind of insurance do you have when you're in a band, Nikki? Do you have like Drew, what do we have? Like SAG?
SAG-AFTRA? Yeah.
We have
both of those.
We have both of those.
So will you get that if you're in a band? Well, I mean, you have it, Donna, but let's say you're only in a rock band.
I see.
Well, we get to cover both, like she's the second on mine, I'm the second on hers.
But if you were just in a rock band?
Just in a rock band after.
Oh, really?
Well, I think that you got that not right away. I mean, you got that from appearing on, like, Leno
what,
and things
like that.
What,
the SAG thing?
AFTRA.
It sounds so not rock and roll to be talking about health insurance. Well, I got my AFTRA from playing at Detroit one night.
I played the Leno show and I got my AFTRA.
I think great
dental.
I got eyeglasses and eye exams. It's great.
Oh, they have votes and everything coming up, Drew.
God.
You ever do that?
Oh, yeah.
Do you vote?
I do. Why not?
You do?
I don't know what the hell I'm voting for. I just...
Oh, really?
About a couple of things, if it makes sense to me.
You puss.
No, like...
I can't believe you.
Remember when they were trying to put AFTRA and SAG together? That made sense to me, yeah.
Did they do it?
No.
Oh. Okay. All I know is once in a while I get something in the mail and I go, hey, that was that chick from Little House on the Prairie.
Yeah, I saw that.
And I go, that's that Mr. Belvedere dude. What? He needs my vote for what? What is he up to? And then it turns out he's like treasurer or something.
Didn't she get confused. Won, right?
Yeah, she won.
Yeah, Melissa Sue Gilbert, I think, is the president. They should be forced to wear the outfit that we know the best in. Like, she should wear like a little smock.
She's branded for life.
Yeah, we should force them to dress in the character that was most popular for them on TV.
Oh,
then they would get my vote. All right, we'll take ourselves a little break. Nikki Sixx is here, along with his beautiful wife, Donna D'Errico. We'll take a quick break. We'll be right back. Hey, everybody, LoveLine. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew over there. Donna D'Errico is our guest tonight, and Nikki Sixx is also here. Donna, you know, from BattleBots and Baywatch. All right, I'm warming up here. And Nikki, of course, you know, from Motley Crue. And I was doing my... strip club DJ impersonation to this song just last night.
Okay.
Yeah. Can we hear a little of that?
Donna. Oh, my God.
Yeah, all right. Go ahead. Crank it up there.
Oh, right. My God.
Yeah, but it was my brand new coming up the stage. Stage 5, brand new show. You appreciate it. I can tell you, but I have to kill you. Sharon, stage 4, Sharon. Show me appreciable. $18 bottles of champagne with all the mini champagne. A little lap dances up in the VIP room. We have the executive lunch coming up. Bobby, line. Stage 1. Isn't that what you hear when you're in a strip club?
Absolutely.
Yes, thank you.
So you did a lot of research.
That's all I hear. You travel the country in strip clubs.
That song is everywhere.
Just hear that, and you hear that fat a-hole in the background. And you're like, please, just a moment of silence so I can focus on my penis. Just a moment's silence for me and my penis. No. And by the way, blaring the rock music, plenty. That's enough.
Yeah.
Yeah, we don't need the other.
Yeah, you know what? You know what it sounds like? It's like it's like when you're driving through the canyon and you're listening to a rock song on a rock station, but you're getting like some AM talk bleeding through, or some other like KCRW, some public radio starting. You're hearing a voice where it shouldn't be, and right. You just want to focus on the ass and the rock. And here's this voice, and then once in a while you got to find the guy. Like, you got to look around.
Got to see what he looks like.
Where's that guy? It's always the same guy. He's about 20, 30 pounds overweight, but he doesn't really dress like it. He's got big arms, but a big gut, but he rolls his sleeves up, and he has the goatee and the hair, and he's wearing some funky shades, and he's trying to hip it up, but he's really just a big jackass. But he does he does get a little sympathy poontang every once in a
you
while.
You think he does?
Once in a while. Here's what happens.
We have those guys on this show.
Here's what happens. Some chick's old man, like... tries to stab her or something, you know.
Oh, he's there.
Yeah, so he offers to drive her home, and you know, and he's like, "Hey, my roommate's out of town. He's at Havasu, and you know, I got an open room. Hey, it's all cool." And then she's like, "Hey, man, you're a good friend, Stu." And then when they get home, he pulls this one. Some guy gave me some coke. Hey, it's cool if you don't want to do it, but, you know, this dude just gave it to me.
Little act.
Does he use the voice, though?
No, he doesn't. No, he doesn't. He doesn't go into the voice. He goes into the sensitive, I'm trying to get laid voice, and then when he comes into the club, that's when he puts his game face on.
And then when she wakes up next to that guy, yeah. It's all bad.
Yeah, it's all bad.
She's long gone.
And then, so she splits?
Yeah.
Yeah,
right
but
afterwards?
Then when he sees her again, he's like, "Hey, I know it was a mistake, and you don't want anyone finding out. You're back together with Kurt, okay? And you don't want any of the girls finding out. And I won't say anything either, but it's going to take a BJ to shut me up." So, just, you know.
The upstanding guy.
That's that guy, yeah. All right, let's get back to the phones and speak to Raj, who's 27. Raj?
Yes.
What's up?
By the way, I wanted to say, Adam, you're cool, man. I'll see in your show, The Man Show.
Thanks, that's Raj. Funny, man. Thank you, Raj.
Anyway, I have been having a little problem with my fiance. I've been with her for 4 years. We got engaged 2 years ago. And I just broke up with her about 2 weeks ago. And we just couldn't seem to find any common ground when we had any problems. I would ask her to, you know, help me solve the problems, but we just couldn't find any common grounds. And when I told her that I wanted to break up, she told me that she didn't want to, and that, you know, she would do anything and everything to, you know, work this relationship out and everything.
Yeah.
But I really needed to.
Hey, Raj, sorry to interrupt. What's your question for us?
I'll let him keep going.
He sounds like Lars Ulrich from Metallica.
Lars?
My question was that should I go back or not? Because, I have kept contact with her, but a very minimal contact.
All I hear is that there was lots of problems in the relationship, the nature of which I can't quite decipher. But relationships that have chronic problems that you've tried to solve over and over usually require more than just a little time apart to make better.
Yeah.
And so unless you've changed or she's changed in some substantive way, no, I wouldn't go back.
Yeah, and you guys have been together for 4 years.
Yes.
It doesn't seem like it's working out too well.
Yeah, that's sort of a no. You gave it a good try.
Is this the first breakup you guys have had?
Yes, this is the first. I was very against breakups. I mean, I always tried to work with all the problems and, you know.
But you always would.
All right. Oh, listen. Okay, give her one more shot.
All right. Whatever.
Okay.
All right.
Just to give another opinion?
Yeah, I don't care. I'm trying to get it moving. Raj, search your heart. People don't really say that enough anymore, do they? That search your heart thing? Mm. That's where the answer is?
Mm-mm.
I guess people know that's just BS.
You know what? I was reading about Egyptians the other day, and they thought the brain had no function. That's why they didn't preserve it when they did all their mummification.
Oh, that's why they stuffed it with hay or something?
They just emptied it out. It was just something to fill your skull with. And the motion was in your chest somewhere.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
They pull your brain out through your nose?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Bad times.
Bad times, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I always thought that would be a bad detail. The guy who was in charge of getting the brain out through the nose. Uh-huh. It's like.
And what'd they do with it?
Just threw it away.
Used it for a child's game. It's a soccer-like game. No, I don't know what they did with
it. Fed it to the farm animals.
Yay!
Yeah. They have to use a hook and drag it out through your nose.
Mm.
Could you do that, Drew?
Good times. Could I do that?
I think I could get mine out if I just blocked one nostril and blew hard.
It's far more civilized these days, and we take a saw and take off the top of the head and pull it out that way.
Is that
way.
What we
that's
do?
Yes, that's what we do now.
Why do we do that? Autopsies?
So, so we can look at it, you know, cross-section it and go through it.
I just went to the full body scan, and they did the thing where they slice every part of your body, you know, your liver, they look at it, the brain.
Unfortunately, that only shows anatomy. And anatomy is a tiny, tiny, tiny little piece of what's important in terms of your health and medical functioning. So,
well, what are they looking for? What did it show?
Well, I was surprised my lungs and liver were good. So I was like, you know, I don't really need to check anymore in that. Figure I got another few more years.
Well, again, no cancer is all they can tell you. Good function. They don't tell anything about
function. They can't look at the heart or see.
They can look at evidence that suggests risk for heart disease.
Right.
But they can't, again, this is a scan really for cancer or vascular disease. Right, that's right.
All right, so you came out okay?
I'm all good.
How do you do it? You go into a thing like it's
MRI.
A CAT scan?
Yeah. It's like an MRI? Like you complained about.
Oh, does it make that god-awful noise?
Yeah.
How long were you
in there? The bing, bing, bong.
No, they don't do that anymore. They don't bang around anymore.
Oh, they don't.
Huh?
How long were you in there?
I think it was about 10 minutes, 15 minutes maybe.
Hmm. How much is it?
It was about a grand.
Oh, yeah. Your health isn't worth $1,000. Jake?
Yeah.
You're 19?
You still got to get that colonoscopy, though.
They were pushing for that.
You got to do that. That's the way more important than a body scan.
Drew will give you one right now.
I thought that's when you were 50.
Not if you really want. Not if you smoke cigarettes or drank, and if you have family history, you start around 40.
I'd been to two doctors, one for a physical and then one for the vasectomy, so I got two thumbs that week.
Oh,
and
really?
You know, I'm fine.
But again, that just means you don't have cancer now. In terms of screening for the things that can turn into cancer, you can actually go up there with a scope and pull them out.
I just got so many things I got to do. Catch up. All the damage I did, yeah?
Yeah. Well, it's all right. You know what you are, Nick? You're like a car that was driven hard, not really maintained. And now it's time to put it up on the rack, take a good look at the bushings, change the fluids. You have a little extra care now because it was not owned by grandmother and just driven to church on
definitely
Sundays.
Definitely not driven by a grandmother.
Jake?
Yeah.
So what's up?
Well, the other night, Dr. Drew was talking about circumcision and reduced risk of cervical cancer.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm not circumcised, and I'm wondering if it would be a good idea to get circumcised.
You know, I would not recommend. I wouldn't recommend that people who are not circumcised sort of run out and get circumcised necessarily. This was just a study that actually was widely published. It was in USA Weekend on the news and stuff. That is a reason to do it in childhood. It's a much more traumatic procedure in adulthood. If you have a reason to do it, you have a stenosis or something, then fine. That's more reason to do it. But they're saying they could reduce cervical cancer in this country, in the world, by like 40%. If
well, in the world, but in this country, it means half of 1%.
I saved the article. Here it is.
I read that.
What?
You read the New England Journal of Medicine?
No, she saw it on Entertainment Tonight. But listen, let me, and Drew, how dare you be condescending?
I'm just teasing.
You read the New England Journal of Medicine, honey? On the set of Baywatch, perhaps?
I'm teasing.
Please, Drew, how dare you attack our guests? You couldn't.
I think I did see it on Entertainment Tonight. I think you're right. Yeah.
Here's thank you. I watch this show too. I have no shame about that. I'm not a reader. That's fine with me. I don't have to brag like Dr. Drew, taking his little Scantron tests on the airplane, reading his important magazines while I'm drinking and complaining about what happened to 8-tracks.
And my mom.
What the hell are we talking about, Drew? Oh, circumcision. Yeah. Now, why would this give women cervical cancer?
Because it increases the risk of the warts.
The warts are spread more easily with guys who are uncircumcised?
Yep. Reduced risk of genital HPV infection in men.
So men have a harder time catching warts when they're circumcised.
They're saying it's an important cofactor in the natural history of HPV infection.
All right, so that's warts.
And may influence the risks of acquisition and transmission.
Okay, so let me just break this down in English for our listeners.
Let me just say, they also point out, article, just a second, that it reduces no penile cancer, reduced risk of HIV infection, and reduced risk of other STDs.
Okay, so let me try to put a put some light on this. You get rid of that foreskin, right?
Yep.
And you sort of essentially dry up and clean up that area at the end there,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And the area, that's the business end of the penis.
That's the one
that's getting all
the
abuse.
The working end, yeah.
Yeah, if it was a hammer, that'd be the head of the hammer, hammer, right?
Or the claw.
The claw of the hammer. Yes. Okay. And the balls would be the handle.
Yeah.
Right. Okay. Right. All right. And so that area is in there, and if you're uncircumcised, maybe it's a little bit moist, and there's extra skin up there, and there's extra area for stuff to latch onto, right? So now the guys who are uncircumcised have a slightly higher chance of getting warts.
Right.
Or of getting HIV.
Right.
Is that what it was saying,
too? That's what it's saying,
too. It can live in there.
It's just they don't really know what that is, but something about that makes it riskier, more likely that you're going to get warts, more likely you're going to transmit warts.
Well, to me, it almost seems like a physical thing. Like if you take something that's sort of smooth and doesn't have any edges on it and slide it in something and pull it out, it's going to have less stuff on it.
And dry and not sort of, you know.
Right. Then something that's sort of moist and has a few ledges and
they've always made a big deal also about there being a thinner layer.
Right.
These guys, so maybe that's how it penetrates.
Okay,
more
so they got a higher chance of getting the warts, and then where the cervical cancer comes in
is
that the guys, because they have a higher chance of having the warts, have a higher chance of passing it on to women.
And they seem to produce more virus and transmit it more readily.
Right. But still in this country, it's probably next to nothing. It's not anything real.
The study was done in this country.
Yeah, but the study was done in this country about worldwide statistics.
No, the data, the extrapolations were to worldwide.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, you don't have any numbers for this country.
Yeah, I'll give them if you want them. Okay. You really want them?
No. Right. We're going to take a break. Here's all I'm saying. You give these stats out and people get a little nutty. This is next to nothing. It's not nothing. It's just next to nothing.
Well, now wait a minute.
In terms of
risk of cervical cancer?
Yeah.
Listen. People are worrying about secondhand smoke. This is a much, much more serious impact on people's
health. I know, but the secondhand smoke whack jobs are their own sort of subset of nut holes.
But if that's going to be an important issue, this is a
massive
issue.
Well, just because they're nuts doesn't mean we have to be nuts, too.
Well, if that's the standard against
which we're measuring. No, that's not the standard. Well, that's a crazy pack of nutty a-holes, and so now we have to turn into a crazy pack of nutty a-holes about this. Let's not be as bad as they are.
I'll get you the numbers when we come back.
Okay, we'll take a break. We'll be right back.
Back in a minute.
Hey, yo, Loveline. I'm Adam. That's Dr. Drew. Nikki Sixx is here. Donna D'Errico is here tonight. Donna is here talking about it's a new stereo line that's dedicated to the ladies. It's by JVC in combination with Urban Decay Cosmetics, right?
That's right. We were in New York last week and just unveiled this big billboard that I'm on in Times Square.
That's cool.
It's really cool. For JVC and Urban Decay, for this line of car stereos, there's a big promotion where you can win one of those new VW Bugs or Beetles, whatever they are.
Right. I think they're both.
Yeah, I can't ever figure out what to call them.
I think
them.
You're right every time.
Yeah.
No matter what you say. But you know, it struck me that car stereos don't really get stolen anymore.
Right.
Or as much as they used to.
What is that?
Well, what it is... There's a couple of things. A, they're cheap.
Mm.
I mean, this is sort of, you can go into a stereo store and for $99 get something with a CD player and a detachable face.
It would have cost $1,250
presets.
Right.
So why rip something off and sell it for $50 when a guy can buy it new for $89? It kills the market. It's kind of sort of the argument of what would happen if they legalized drugs. Mm-hmm. It kills it. I mean, if you want to know really how to get rid of crime, it's not really by putting the bars up or getting more security guards. It's just you just kill the market.
Price.
The price is gone. Price. Yeah, I mean, you make Coke 50 cents a pound. there's not going to be any more shooting. I don't know if that's going to be a good thing or not, but it definitely gets rid of the crime that surrounds it. I'll tell you that right now. And I remember, and also cars come with nice stereos now, a lot of them that are integrated.
The anti-theft.
And they have the anti-theft thing, and it's like the Mercedes stereo is not going to fit in the BMW.
And if you steal it, if some code thing goes off and it won't work.
Right.
Even if they hook it back up into a car.
Right, right. And so there's all that. So it just, it's not a business anymore. But I think we can all remember a day when you were pulling, there was first thing, you'd pull out the whole stereo.
The whole thing, I remember that. There was a little handle thing.
Yeah, you would
there.
Actually yank out the entire stereo, which was sort of like walking around for your whole day with a lunch pail, but as an adult, like a heavy electronics lunch pail. And then here's what inevitably would happen. The two things would happen. A, you'd be carrying it around and drop it somewhere, so you'd like destroy your own stereo. B, you'd get it stolen while you're carrying it around, ironically. You'd leave it on the table, the restaurant, you'd go take a leak, you'd come back, it'd be gone, you'd leave it somewhere, or what would always end up happening is you, those things were made to slide in and out about 25 times successfully before they started jamming and wedging. So you'd start pulling on it, and the whole dash would start moving. I was at a certain point where my whole car moved backwards when I pulled on the thing. And everything's, and you try to put it back, and it's like it doesn't play, so you slide it out halfway, and then you jam it back in there. It just, people had to know that wasn't going to work.
Yeah.
And that cost you $500-$600. Then they came with the detachable face. But you'd start getting lazy. You'd leave that in there. You'd start hiding the face. Then what you'd do, like some people would leave, they put a little decoy crappy AM in there, put the good one in the glove box. Think about the hassle. I spray painted my stereo because I didn't want it to get ripped off in the late 80s.
There's the one, the JVC one I saw that, when you turn it off, everything...
It all disappears.
It all disappears. Like, it folds into itself, and just, it's a black...
Just a black, flat...
Too much work for a stereo, though.
That's cool.
It's really cool to watch.
Oh, it's really cool.
I was turning it on and off and on and off and on. It was really, really...
Days of smoking pot.
Don't admit that, Donna.
On and off, on and off.
Yeah.
If you saw it yourself, you'd do the same thing.
In 1985, Donna stared at a mood ring for 28 hours straight once. Little known fact.
Hey, back to the male circumcision and cervical cancer and warts and all that. I stand completely corrected. That study was not done in the United States. It was done in Brazil, Colombia, Thailand, Philippines, and Spain.
All right, well, let me say two things. One, maybe the Jews got it right with the circumcision. Maybe that is a way to clean things up. But two, this is what I've been saying for the last few months. We've run out of serious problems and health epidemics in this country, and now we got to go worldwide to get stats to scare us. So meaning when we're talking about AIDS now, we're talking about AIDS worldwide,
right,
and we're mainly focusing on Africa.
Right.
And see, it's hard to say, like, hey, we need your money, but don't worry, this, we got it under control.
Yeah.
Like Magic Johnson has had this thing since he was in junior high, and he's still playing ball. That doesn't get you money. So we go, the highest rate of homosexual is males. Males are getting, young heterosexual women are getting it. But what they're talking about is they're talking about Africa
right now.
My favorite thing is CNN runs the International Trachoma Society. 1 million cases of blindness every year. They're talking about chlamydia.
They are.
Chlamydia, yeah.
How many cases of blindness in the United States?
Oh, zero. Oh, no. Oh, people
That's
be
my
sued
point.
From here to eternity if it happened here.
That's my point. So here's what I'm saying. From now on, I want to know if you're talking about this country or other countries, so I know whether to tune out or not. Because you start talking about disease, and you're talking about Mozambique, or you're talking about some place in Central America, that's what I expect out of those countries. That's why they're them and we're us, goddammit. Thank
you. Let's heal some babies!
Thank you. Chris?
Yeah.
You're 16?
Yeah. What's up, guys?
All right.
Hey, man.
What do you want? We're already tired of you.
You're already tired of me.
All right, hang on. He had a horrible line. Joe. Joe?
Hello?
You got a question for Nikki?
Yeah, I do. I want to know, I don't know if this is a rumor or what, but I heard that some of the guys from Motley Crue actually shot up alcohol, and I want to know if that's true.
Yeah, it's true.
What did they shoot up?
They being me and Tommy.
You were one of them?
Yeah. We were on a... kind of on a cocaine run for a long time. We ran out of anything to come down from, or anything to shoot up or anything. And so me and Tommy decided that the way to come down, we're in the tour bus out in the middle of the country, was to shoot up alcohol. Nasty.
What kind of alcohol did you shoot up?
Jack Daniels.
And how did you do it? Like, how did you know how much to put in there?
You know, we just kind of filled the syringe and just did it.
And
we were out of our minds.
What did it feel like?
You know what? I was instantly drunk.
Oh, really?
Instantly drunk. But it was very bizarre.
You were pretty effed up when you did it, though, too,
yeah,
right?
Yeah, I was, like, all jacked up on blow, but...
Oh, I see.
How did you not get an infection from that?
I don't know.
Well, it's alcohol,
Drew. Maybe nothing would live in our bodies in those days, you know?
Wow.
Well,
that's how people get heart valve infections, injecting weird stuff.
Really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, what about it, Drew? I mean, what is the difference between injecting...
Well, it does get
drinking
into your blood
booze
stream.
Yeah, but you're injecting... I mean, your body absorbs the alcohol and everything else goes out.
Right.
You're putting all the impurities in there. Not only that, whatever bacteria.
It's charcoal filter.
I mean, if you injected water into your system, it would be a disaster.
It would?
Yeah.
All right. Well, look at him now. He just had the CAT scan.
He's
doing great.
All good. It's all good.
He's a poster boy for injecting foreign objects into his materials into his bloodstream. So you injected yourself with alcohol, and you could immediately feel it.
Immediately.
Well, that makes sense.
And that makes sense, sure. And that
was kind of surreal.
And I want to talk about this a little more because I'm curious about the amount, too, and if you felt more. I'm looking at ways to stretch out a fifth. Basically,
I was just
going to
say, you'd save a lot of money.
Absolutely.
Well, I mean, that's why drug addicts start using syringes in the first place. It saves, you know.
Okay. Well, we're gonna right talk there about the economy side of drug and alcohol abuse with Nikki and Donna after this.
All right, guys. Bottom line, here's the deal. Looking to hook up?
Sick of wasting time with the wrong person? One call's all you need to make. Call the Dateline.
877-889-DATE. LoveLine with Adam Carolla and Dr. Drew.
1-800-LOVE-191.
We'll be right back.
Hey, everybody, LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That's Dr. Drew over there. Nikki Sixx is here tonight from Motley Crue, and Donna DiErico, his lovely wife, is here. You know, from Baywatch, and also one of the shows I enjoy, BattleBots, but you probably didn't enjoy BattleBots, did you, Donna?
You know what? I
no.
A lot of nerds there.
No, when they initially offered it to me, I thought it sounded kind of dumb, but...
Yeah.
When I got there and it started, I have to admit, it was kind of cool.
Got a little caught up in it, huh?
Kind of got a little cool.
Central, though, over there, yeah?
I don't know. Yeah. There were
calling
quite a few
all nerds.
There were some nerds, but...
I went down there.
There were a lot of kids, too, and it was, I don't know.
A lot of young budding nerds there.
It was
with
just kind of, I kind of got caught up in it, because these machines are just so cool, and the remote controls are like the size of...
Remote controls?
No, they're massive
remote
controls with all these buttons. It was crazy. And people build these things.
Something's bound to go wrong eventually there, because those things have, like, you know, saw blades and pickaxes.
Yeah.
And, you know, they have these like pneumatic canisters that have like 2,000 tons of pressure and stuff. Something's going to kick on and go through some guy's boot.
But it just seems to me, when I watch it, it could be just a little more violent.
I was going to say,
kind of violent, but not...
I
really
want it to graduate into, like, being able to have
rocket,
you know,
launchers,
shoot each other,
yeah,
you know, have projectile
watts.
Yeah, but you know the thing is it strikes me, and a lot of people have that argument with BattleBots, but it sort of ends up that way with everything that's violent about 95% of the time, but you're waiting for that 5%. Like, for instance, heavyweight boxing matches. You'd say, oh man, this is going to be the battle to end all battles. But it turns into a wrestling match, and there's a lot of pushing and leaning and guys dragging guys across the ring. But once in a while, once out of every 50 heavyweight fights or heavyweight championship fights, there's Frazier Ali.
You know
what I'm saying? And that's kind of what you're waiting for. And if it was that way all the time, then maybe it wouldn't be as big a deal. And the same with the BattleBots. 90% of the matches are them pushing each other back and forth and something goes wrong with one. But once in a while, Ziggo gets ahead of steam and sends some other middleweight just sailing across the arena. And it's exciting.
I saw the Foreman Ali fight. Some guy was playing it on a DVD and next to me on a plane. That was an amazing fight, too. I didn't remember that one.
Yeah, but that's...
Beat the crap out of each other.
Oh, the Foreman, the first one?
The first Foreman Ali fight, yeah.
Yeah, that was... That's the point. That's why you remember those sort of hand out of the hundreds and hundreds and thousands of championship fights. You remember five or six of them. Mm. And that's why they're up at the next level.
And I thought to myself, and George Foreman's selling
crockpots, grillers,
and Ali can't walk.
Yeah.
It's amazing.
I know. And it's the guy who won.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's really the crazy part. All right. Oh, and Donna is here tonight to talk about
JVC, Urban Decay Car Stereo.
So where in Times Square do we see it? Where do we look?
You know what? It's...
just a big billboard, by the way.
Yeah, it's a big billboard they just unveiled last week. And it's right across from MTV where they do TRL.
Mm-hmm. Are you holding the stereo?
And ESPN too, right?
Yeah, that's right, ESPN. It's, you know what, I'm on the billboard with a few other, there's a pro surfer, pro skateboarder, and a pro snowboarder on there. And then the creative director, Wendy, of Urban Decay, and Lisa Loeb. And we're all on there, and
it's very pro woman.
It's very women empowering, and
all women.
Oh,
okay.
But women's.
Lisa Loeb played that day, and I was pretty.
Yeah,
amazed.
I was blown away.
I mean,
She's really good.
Just a guitar and a microphone in her voice, and she was really good.
Nice woman too.
She is very nice.
She's very witty,
and hot in a kind of sleeper way.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I'm into her. That's she'd be fine with me. I don't think. I'd be fine with her.
He'd do her if she left the glasses on.
Oh, you like the librarian?
Yeah, she got a little of that librarian thing going on, but she's really hot and she's talented.
She's been dating what's his name?
Dweezil.
Yeah, Dweezil Zappa. 3 years.
Yeah, I'm gonna have him killed actually. Natalie.
Yeah.
You're 13.
Is there what?
You're 13 years old.
Yeah, I am.
What's up?
Nothing. Well, I haven't gotten my period, and I'm about like a week and a half late.
Mm-hmm.
And I was just wondering what's wrong.
Did you have any sex?
No, never.
All right, so you're just late. But how regular have you been in the past?
It's been not too late. I mean, the latest it's been is maybe 3 days at the most.
And how late is it this time again?
Week and a half.
Week and a half, 10 days, and you
no sex.
Last year, I didn't get it for 3 months once.
All right, so you have been late before, so you'll be late again. That's very common.
Oh, okay.
Very common. Are you on any medication?
Well, right now I'm on a medication. I'm not sure what it's called, but it's for just for acne. And
minocycline? Minocin?
No, I don't think so.
Not Accutane?
No, it's not.
No. Okay.
Last year when I didn't get it for 3 months, I was on Zoloft.
All right, well, this all happens for sure. Common. You didn't have sex, so you can't be pregnant.
Right, okay.
All right.
Thanks.
Jeez, it's just,
I got scared there.
Like she got pregnant?
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Well, we have 13-year-olds that are active, but
what's
what's
lately the normal starting age?
15 and a half.
Is that what it is?
Getting your period.
Oh, getting your period? I thought you meant for sexual activity. Getting your period is a little around 12. Oh. The menarche symptoms are coming out earlier, like 7, 8.
Really?
So pre-puberty is what's dropped down.
Why? What is that?
That's actually like breast bud development and
do hormones start kicking in at that point?
Not the estrogen hormones. It's actually the adrenal hormones are kicking in earlier. Nobody knows.
7, 8.
They're not cycling yet.
Why is that? It seems like it's earlier and earlier all the time.
It is. It's so crazy because Time Magazine reported it must be the estrogens in the chickens we're eating and this kind of stuff.
Oh, right.
It's a non-estrogen mediated phenomenon. It's the adrenal glands mediating this whole thing. The age at which the period starts hasn't changed in 100 years. But the pre-period changes, the stuff that comes, the hair growth and all that stuff.
And sex is starting at 15 and a half.
In this country. In this country.
Boys and girls?
It's a little younger for boys and girls, but it's under 16, like for both.
But for our callers, you can knock 8 years off of that.
Easily.
Our guys start about 7 and a half.
As opposed to Holland, where it's like 17.8.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Oh, really?
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah, I wonder where we rank.
We're the worst in industrialized countries.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Really? You bent it right up, huh?
Yeah. Yeah. But,
in France, it's 17.
Is it?
Yeah, it's crazy.
Yeah, but, once, but you know they get started, they don't stop over there.
But you know what? Well, it's fine. But you
I don't. I don't get it. Our oldest son's 11. He hates girls. How's he going to get to 14 and just be ready to jump in the sack?
Oh, that's a lot's going to happen in the next.
Yeah, 11 to 14 is a pretty.
Just think back, Nikki.
I was going at 9.
You really? You were into girls at 9?
Well, I thought it was in, but I was rolling around in the closet.
Right.
Yeah.
But you had that, and also guys. Guys vary quite a bit. Mm-hmm. I mean, there are guys that we talk to that are 17 that sound like they're 13.
Mm-hmm.
And then there are guys we talk to who are 12, 13 that sound like Vietnam veterans.
Yeah.
So right. You never know. But the late bloomers, it's better for the parents and better for the kids. So.
Yeah.
Well, theoretically, what these other countries have are intact families. And that seems to be the big ingredient. Mm. I mean, it couldn't be more open sexually than Holland. And yet they delay. And they have great family systems. There you go.
Marie?
Yes.
You're 24?
Hi.
What's up?
I'm just having a problem where I'm startled really easily, like, even for the smallest thing.
Drew, you should move to Holland soon.
Why? Nothing for me
to
do there.
Your kids are getting
old. Yeah, you're right. Yeah,
you know,
good,
just hook up an ISDN line over there. You'll be fine.
Yeah.
Marie, go ahead.
I'm just startled really easily, and it's not like if somebody just sneaks up on me and tries to scare me, but... Just in normal situations, like even at work, if my boss comes up.
Are you a trauma survivor of some type?
Scared the crap out of Donna, by the way.
Speaking of an exaggerated startle response.
Yeah.
Are you a trauma survivor, Marie?
Well, I was physically abused when I was a child.
Okay, well, that's trauma. And do you ever dissociate? Do you go into periods of sort of where you freeze and you get frightened to the point that you can't sort of do anything?
No. I can still function. It's just...
I don't mean necessarily when you have a startle. I mean, do you have experiences where you just kind of freeze and dissociate?
Like when I'm interacting with people?
Or in a situation that seems overwhelming.
Oh, yes.
Yeah. And that this is all sort of symptoms of post-traumatic stress reaction. Maybe not necessarily meeting criteria for the true disorder, but this sort of fluctuation between excessive hyperexcitability and startle responses and then these freezing dissociative episodes are real characteristic of that. So it's something worth looking into. Having survived physical abuse is a really serious thing. And,
oh, was there a lot of abuse?
Why would this have started so much later, though? I'm 24 now.
No, who knows?
Yeah, it's hard to say. But it here it is. And that's what PTSD sometimes is. Some other stressor brings it out or some relationship falls. Something. You
who
get more
abused
depressed.
You? Your dad?
My mother, mostly. My dad, some. But mostly my mom.
What's her nationality? One of those wacky ones that beats on
kids? White as white can be.
Aha! Okay. And she did a lot of beating on you?
Yeah.
Okay. Well, a little therapy ought to cure that. Maybe about 15 years?
No, 5 years.
5 years.
5 years.
5 years. 5 years every day. Mm-hmm. 15 every other day.
Do you guys know of any therapy places that you can go to if you're sort of in between insurance? I'm going to be starting grad school soon, so it will kick in then.
Well, the wherever you're going to school, I'm sure we'll have mental health services. Right?
Okay, so just wait.
I'd wait till that, yeah.
Okay.
All right, baby.
Thanks.
Yeah, good times, right?
All right. Bye.
Yeah. All right, everyone's a mess.
Good times.
And you know, who knows why all this stuff kicks in when it kicks in, but it's always interesting to me, like when I see these biographies.
Mm.
And you got, like, Donny Osmond up there.
When he has his panic attacks.
And he's talking about the guy, you know, he was born on stage. He's doing 300 gigs a year by the age 8. And then somehow at age 39, he has to go out on stage and do Jack and his amazing trench coat. Or what the hell show is
he? Colored cream coat.
Morris and his multicolored gauchos. What was that?
Something
in his amazing Technicolor dream coat. Jesus. The point is he's in his dressing room and he can't walk out on stage. He's petrified. You know, he's having a panic attack.
He needs you to go in there and go, hey, get out there. If I have to wait here 1 second for you.
Hey, Osmond. Hey, horse teeth. Hit the stage. Let's rock. We got the ice capades coming in here on Sunday. We gotta clean up. What the hell is it? Joseph.
Joseph, the amazing Technicolor.
Right. Here's my point.
It.
Why does this stuff kick in 35 years after the fact. You know, I mean, here's this guy on stage his entire life doing everything. Everything. I mean, the guy's doing a show with his sister when he's on you know, prime time when he's 17.
Usually,
no problem with it.
That kind of thing is usually depression.
Is that what it is?
Yeah, that biology.
When he couldn't go out?
He's having panic attacks, but really the biology he's in is depression at that point.
Right. But I guess the question is why now? And the answer is, who the hell knows?
Yeah.
But it's here.
Yeah.
So that lady that was on the phone just now, even though this stuff happened when she was a child, this reaction now when she's 24, that's still considered post-traumatic stress?
Oh, yeah. That's one of the more... I mean, addicts, this is what we're dealing with all the time. That's most... I would dare say most of my addict patients now, that's what they're trying to treat. That's what they're looking to really get relief from.
Kind of like Adam's saying, I just always imagined post-traumatic stress syndrome to be what happens immediately after.
There is that also. But there is very, very commonly chronic post-traumatic stress in people that are trauma survivors from childhood. And they fluctuate between flooding and flashbacks and dissociation and frozen and sort of detached. And they go back and forth and back and forth.
And depending on what you do with your life, just kind of stuff it down.
Stuff it. I've dealt with that. It's no big deal. But the physiologic imprint is there. And if something, some stressors come along, you can't keep it under wraps anymore, and pow, it comes out.
But in a way, it's like an injury. Like if you blow out your knee in high school playing football, it's screwed up for a couple months. Then you're good for 25 years. Then
now
it starts hurting again.
Now you're skiing and you're 50 and it doesn't work anymore.
Now you can't do Joseph in the Amazing Technicolor Dreamcoat at age 50 skiing.
That's right.
Is that what you're saying?
I have no idea what you're talking about.
That was a big Broadway play. What the hell?
That Debbie Gibson did, remember?
Yeah, we had her in here. I don't know. Drew, maybe we shouldn't be admitting that we know these musicals.
It's a musical.
Yeah, one of these lame musicals, the Fagalacy. I barely heard of it, but this one gay guy was talking about it once, and I remember it. Pat, it was cool the way we pretended not to remember the guy's name. Pat, you're 19.
Yeah.
What's up?
I don't believe it. Whatever it is, it's what's up, Pat?
I'm really attracted to married men.
Mm-hmm. All right. And have you always been that way?
No, just recently.
And
yeah, I don't believe Pat.
She doesn't sound like she believes her.
Yeah.
You dating a married guy now, Pat?
Yeah, but we're trying to kind of keep it low because. He's actually a friend of the family's.
Mm-hmm.
Like, he talks to my aunt a lot, and that's actually who I met him through.
He touched your who?
He flirts with my aunt.
He what? Plays with your aunt?
Flirts.
Oh.
Flirts.
Oh, flirts.
And that's who I met him through?
Your aunt.
Mm-hmm.
How old is he? Listen, I don't care. Pat, I don't care. You got to get it together if you're going to be on this show.
Whatever.
She's 19.
Tara, Damien.
Oh, wow, 19.
You got to be able to form a sentence.
She also sounded younger
don't
than
put
19.
Him on.
All right.
Okay.
Keep going.
I'll just put her on hold for
keep
a while.
Keep it moving.
All right. Matt?
Yes, hi.
You're 29. What's up?
Yes. Hi. Well, I married my wife in 93, and the first 7 years were kind of rocky.
Why? What was the problem?
Well, you know, I guess I was a dick, you know. So,
that'll do it.
What did you do?
I'm a car salesman.
No,
and
so it's in your blood.
I'm out a lot, you know, and stuff there, so.
Yeah.
You know, but I think, you know, my wife's been hanging out with, you know, some new lady friends, and, you know, they do the C-block thing when they go out.
What's that? What does that mean?
Well, you know, they kind of...
Anderson just yelled no
C-block
into
is,
my ear.
The rooster block.
Oh.
Just don't get him to say the word.
Oh, he can't say,
block, C-block.
C-block, which is the C... with
wiener blocking, yeah.
Wiener block. They go out and they...
It's kind of like throwing salt in the game. It's making sure that they don't get.
Oh, he left. He dropped off.
Oh, he dropped off? All right.
Okay.
All right.
That was getting good.
Yeah.
I learned something.
Yeah, C block, I thought, was something that had to do with a computer or a woman's prison.
Yeah, I thought it was cell block.
Brady?
Yes.
You're
21? How are you?
What's up?
Actually, I've got a few things. First of all, I'd love to tell you guys that I love your show. I listen to you guys every night faithfully.
Thank you.
And I want to tell you guys I was in jail about a year ago for like 22 months, and I listened to you guys every night. I didn't miss one night.
Did they give you a radio in there?
Yeah, they sucked, but...
Really? You got a radio in jail?
Yeah, a little like AM, FM radio.
Good times.
That's kind of cool.
It's not bad. Was it that JVC brand that's powder?
Believe it or not, it was
actually
powder
blue?
Sony.
No. Sony,
okay. Sony, okay.
You can get it at Shopko for like $8.95, but they charge us $35.
Brady's going to have his picture up in Times Square with a bunch of other inmates.
So what's the question, Brady?
It would empower prisoners. All right. So go ahead, Brady.
One more thing. While I was in there, I got sent over to Del Amo Hospital for sex addiction treatment.
How'd you like it?
It was entertaining and eye-opening, I think would be the best word.
Well, it's a good program. It's thought of.
Yeah, it is. And Dr. Drew, I actually did talk to you when I was down there. I talked to you about a relationship things, and you told me, I remember one time you told me, and I still remember this to this day. That
wait a minute, how could I have talked to you at Del Amo?
Well, I give you like a call on the radio.
You've called on the radio before, huh?
Yeah. And you told me like the best way to treat relationships is you have to be like proactive in relationships.
Yeah.
And you said your behavior is an effect of your condition, not of your conditions. And I thought that was really cool.
Is that what you said? If it was cool, Drew probably didn't say it. Where'd they keep you over at Del Amo? In C Block?
No, it was a lock. I don't know exactly where it was. It was in the back corner. Like, I really have
but
no
let, let's okay. let, can we talk about this for 1 second, though? Because there are a lot of perpetrators there, right?
What do you mean,
yeah,
perpetrator?
People like, for instance, there's this whole scandal about priests and sexual abuse.
Right, right.
And people like that. You were amongst a lot of patients like that, right, Brady?
Yeah, and there were also people there voluntarily that had come to stop before they got to the offending.
And right. that's really the idea of a place like Del Amo is before you break a law or harm somebody, this is a condition that's treatable. Are you in some form of recovery now?
Yeah, I am. I'm in... sex addiction therapy with a really good therapist.
Fabulous.
Up at the Utah State University.
Excellent.
Good.
Yeah, so it is good.
So what's the question?
Well, I was wondering, is it possible to impregnate someone while they're on their menstruation cycle?
Yes, it's possible.
But it's not probable.
Not probable.
Because, I'm having like a hard time with that because from what I understand, like, the egg is not in there. When that's happening, it's flushed out already. And
yes, but your sperm will live for 3 days up in the tubes, and in the meantime, another egg can get released.
Is that what'll happen?
Yes.
What's the blood? Does that do anything to your sperm?
Not really.
Just kind of makes it into Thousand Island?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Oh, is that a mess? That is such
a
mess.
Makes it, it's bumping into things on its way up. But
it gets by the blood.
Bumping into some blood clots.
Sure. All right, so here's the deal. If you blood have clots. Sex with somebody when they're on their period, I know you can't put a number on it.
Much less risk.
Much less likely.
We always thought, yeah.
It's a safe bet.
Again,
it's
sperm,
like all odds are against it.
Sperm stays in the fallopian tube for 3 days, hanging out, just
but
hangs
the, but
out.
Then there's not the there's nothing like it's harder to adhere
attach,
to the wall,
yeah.
Right?
Because no. I'll take then a few more days for once the egg hits the sperm to come down the tubes and get to the uterus. Your period's long over by then.
So get a vasectomy.
Yeah.
That's the deal.
That's what Nikki did.
That's what I did.
That's why I always play it safe. If I don't use a condom, give just a little shot of compressed air up there. Really,
nice.
just to take the sperm out.
Sure, why not?
All right, we're going to take a little break. Donna D'Errico is here tonight. Nikki Sixx is here tonight. We'll be right back after this.
Loveline. We'll be right back.
Hey, everybody, LoveLine. I'm Adam Carolla. That's Dr. Drew. Nikki Sixx is here tonight. Donna D'Errico is here tonight. Donna's here for the Urban Decay cosmetic line, which is combined with that JVC and their stereo line. Doing a stereo that is geared for women. It's got comes in colors, got the credit card remote control, and reasonably priced.
Very. It's under $200. I think it's $175.
I say to Drew, do I say this to you every night on the ride home? What do I say to you?
That you wish you had a remote control stereo that was chartreuse for under $100.
No, but that was rare, Drew. That was actually mildly entertaining. I like that. No, never been a better time to be poor.
Oh, that's right. It's true. You say that all the time.
Never has. I mean, when I was poor, if you bought a cheap car, it was a piece of ass.
Yeah.
I mean, there were if you had some money, you wanted to get a BMW or Mercedes, fine. Or you didn't have any money, you had to drive a Chevette or a Vega or something that people made fun of you for. Now, if you got 19 grand, you got 19 grand to spend on a car, you get a Mini Cooper, you get a Golf GTI. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Thing's got like a 6-speed, a navigation system in it. Right. It works. Mm-hmm. It kicks ass. It's got like Recaro seats and a Momo steering wheel and like 18-inch rims on it. And it would blow away a Porsche from 10 years ago.
Yeah.
And it's got a 100,000-mile warranty. You can have a home stereo system, like home theater unit in there with like a, you can get a big screen. I mean, like a 24-inch color TV was like $600 when I was poor. Now they're free, Drew. You understand they give them away?
For car wash.
Yeah, you get a car wash, you fill up with gas, you get a 24-inch color TV. Now you get these like little miniature home theater systems with the small speakers. You get the whole thing, comes in one bucket. It's like $400-$500.
Right.
There's never been a better time to be poor. A VCR is $89. It's got four heads, and it's got all the remotes and
DVD's
everything.
DVD's only $100+.
Yeah.
Oh,
cell phones are cheap. Computers are cheap now.
No, perfect time to be poor.
I'm liking it.
Yeah. Let's get poor. Yeah, let's do it. Let's all put a hand in here and commit to being poor. And when I see you guys next year, I want you to bring your tax return in. I want you to be making less than you did the previous year.
Oh, we can do that.
Mike?
Yeah.
You're 33?
Yes.
What's up?
Hey, not much. You were talking earlier when you're on the radio that you had a vasectomy.
Nikki was, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, and unfortunately, I'm going tomorrow to get mine.
Oh, yeah. Well, buy a bag of peas.
A bag of peas? Oh, yeah.
Frozen peas.
Frozen peas. It's very
right on the nuts.
Yeah, they kind of mold.
Yeah, a little better than I.
I was doing the vasectomy shuffle up and down the hallway.
Yeah.
Oh, I'm not looking forward to this at all. But
it's actually not that bad.
Well, that's what I was curious about, because the doctor, they always have their viewpoint on it, and it always seems to be a little sugar-coated. And,
mild discomfort is sort of code for watch out.
I mean, you know what? I had myself so worked up. I was convinced this is the end of the world.
Plus, it was a little harder for Nikki because they had to really go on the hunt for one of them and like go in a couple times.
One of the tubes was what do you call that?
Find it?
Hiding.
But yeah, I know there's some terminology for it. I don't know, but he had to really hunt for it because if he didn't get it, and it was working.
Mm-hmm.
So I basically had 5 kids with just one tube.
Oh really?
Shooting just on the right.
Wow,
pretty good.
Yeah.
I've got two, I'm done.
Yeah. Well, and you know, the worst part is the shot, and then after that, it's pretty much, it's all good.
And how long are you...
The smell of burning flesh is a little freaky, but...
Yeah, they cauterize it.
Yeah,
right?
that's...
How long are you sore for?
They don't want to cauterize it, because the fact of the smell is it kind of nauseates the patient, so they don't do that.
Right.
They just tie them and cut them.
All right there, Mike. Oh. Well, good times there, buddy.
So what, do they just leave it in a knot?
No.
By the end?
Cut and tie it with a suture.
Oh, okay. And it heals that way.
Sweet dreams tonight, Mike. Sweet dreams, buddy.
Good luck, dude.
We'll talk to Jane, who's 33. Jane?
Hi.
Hey.
How's it going?
Good. What's up?
I'm having a lot of problems dating lately. I haven't been in a relationship for about 3 years. I suffer from paranoid schizophrenia, but I'm stable right now.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm wondering, how would this affect anyone that I begin to date? And if so, how should I break it to them?
To women, women don't get this as much as men, do they?
I believe that's true.
I wonder why that is. I think we just have bigger brains. More can go wrong. That's the way I always look at it. More advanced, you know, more stuff to go wrong.
I see, more, yeah.
Jane?
Yeah.
I think if you're stabilized and, you know, you're taking your meds and all that stuff, most guys would be okay with this.
Yeah.
It's more how you act.
Right. If they're already attracted to you and they're in getting involved, I think it's reasonable to tell people that you're getting involved with, that you have chronic conditions or you take medication, that kind of thing. But specifics, I wouldn't get into until you really have established a relationship.
Really?
I think so.
What are you doing? Are you able to work?
Unless they ask.
Well, I'm trying to get back to working now. I haven't been working for a couple of years now.
How come?
I've been in and out of hospitals because of the anxiety and the panic attacks and the hallucinations.
Mm-hmm.
Do you hear voices?
No, not anymore. I don't.
You're insane. You didn't just hear that? Scared Donna again.
She had another exaggerated startle reaction.
Yeah, I used to freak out.
All right. All right, so just get back and start dating.
Okay.
All right.
All right, thanks.
Yeah, you're all right.
Okay.
Hey, maybe you find a guy who's got the same condition.
Well, I don't know if I want to find someone with the same condition, though.
Oh, I see, yeah. Yeah, you don't want one of them losers, right?
Right.
All right there, baby.
Okay, thanks.
I like that. Yeah, I like when fat guys make fun of chicks for being fat.
Right.
Like, guys like 180 pounds overweight, and it's like, yeah, she was okay, but her ass was a little big. It's like, hey, Lardo, Jesus Christ, look at you. I like when people do that. It's good, though, you know?
Why?
I don't know. There's something healthy about someone who's a schizophrenic not wanting to date someone who's schizophrenic because who wants one of them?
It's acknowledging how difficult it is dealing with a chronic mental health issue, which is showing insight.
Yeah.
Rather than denying her own thing, it's showing insight that, yeah, this is a tough thing to deal with. And one in a relationship is enough.
Now, see, for a guy, I'll tell you what's in it for a guy. He can get residual sex after he breaks up with other women by saying that he dated somebody. Like if you say you dated some chick and she was in a wheelchair and all that kind of stuff, I think it would help when you were single after that, you could get laid easier. You know what I mean?
I don't know if that would apply.
But Donna,
I agree.
You agree?
Maybe the wheelchair thing, yeah. What if I came?
Well, you said you were someone with a psycho. LA.
Donna, what if I worked this with you? Like, what if I said, like, what if you were just single, let's just say. And let's just say Nikki, like, you just blew up or something, just like combusted. It happens.
Right.
It happens to guys in bands a lot. Or that injection of Jack Daniels.
Went wrong, yeah,
and
right.
We're single. And we meet up at some party or something. And I give you this rap. I tell you, listen. Yeah, my last girlfriend, she, cerebral palsy. And it was fine with me. A lot of people had a problem with it. But I loved her, you know. And I didn't see the palsy. I saw the woman. And we broke up, you know. Actually, it was mutual. You'd like me more,
yeah.
Would you not?
Okay, I admit it, yeah.
Yeah.
You ever used that before?
No, but I'm going to start.
It sounds really worked out.
I know.
You know, I totally
agree.
That's
the beauty of me. That's why I lie well. It's things sound worked out.
You're totally right. But if you changed that to a mental illness, I don't think that same thing. I don't know.
Doesn't apply the same way.
I don't think so.
All right. Well, I won't do that.
So,
I'll keep it
about
at
physical.
I'll keep it at the palsy.
Well, it's about okay. But right. I think it's more about impairment, you know, about.
Yeah.
It's like if he can love her,
right,
and she's not perfect.
What's the word I'm looking for?
Handicapped.
Yeah. All right. So that's good. That works well.
The handicapped one. Yeah, I could see that.
Yeah, you know, it works good too. It's like, a lot of people couldn't handle it because she had to use those kind of crutches. You know, the ones with the thing that went on your forearm.
You couldn't have sex because her pelvic muscles
were too. She walked funny. Yeah, I mean, we could have sex, but it was rare, and it's only when she wanted it, and I'd have to go down on her for hours. An hour.
And I was fine with that.
And I was fine with that. Yeah.
Yeah. Then you you'd
get laid that night.
Yeah. A lot of guys. Oh, yeah. And it was, I got to admit, it was hard. And, you know, a lot of guys wondered what I was doing, but I thought she was beautiful because I saw what was inside.
Oh, God. That would so work.
You're getting hot now, right?
I was going to be all these guys in bars tonight out there
trying
that line.
Are girls that easy to figure out?
Yeah.
And dupe like that?
Our listeners are going to be at bars going, she had Parable Halsey. Parable Talsey. She was a gimpo.
You little old Jack.
Yeah, she's like gimpoed. Whatever. Anyway, I didn't do her that much. So can I have some? they would screw it up. Kyle?
Yeah.
You're 17?
Yes.
What's up?
Okay. I've been going out with my girlfriend for a year and 2 months, and I really fell in love with her. Mm-hmm. With her forever. I told her that. And
she ran away.
What?
And she ran away.
No. What kind of... her parents... I live with her because... Me and my parents my mom's not doing so good. So I moved in with her. I've been living there for like 6 months. And it's been great. And we had a really good relationship. I had to go out of town for a week because her parents were leaving and she like made out with another guy.
Oh, really?
Yeah. So well,
what's up with your mom? Why do you have to get out of there?
She has a bipolar disease. It's really hard to live with her.
Okay.
With that, I'm always yelling and stuff.
Yeah, use cerebral palsy. It's better. You get laid more.
Yeah, and, well, I'm trying to get, it's been like a week, just, you know.
Right. Why did your girlfriend make out with this other guy? How'd you find out about it?
Through friends. I find everything out.
Okay. So,
Is she manic currently?
Mad?
Manic.
Well, this isn't her. This is his
mom. Oh, the mom's bipolar. Well, yeah.
Was she drinking?
That's why he's been living with...
Were they drinking at a party, or...?
Yes, but she didn't really get that drunk.
All right, well, did she just kiss the guy?
No, they made out, and they did it a couple times, and I
well, what's making out? That's kissing, right?
Well, yeah, she had a hickey on her neck.
Okay.
And you're still living there?
No, well, kind of. I'm with some other friends.
So you're bumming.
Forgave her, but, and told her I'd have her back, but she says she doesn't want me anymore and everything.
All right, well, that's it.
That's that.
Well, and I'm trying to get over it, and I want to, you know, like, have sex with other girls, and, you know.
Except they women get together and have a meeting.
Yeah, except for you can't.
Yeah, they have a meeting. They exclude guys that have just broken up with a girlfriend.
You're known as the damaged one.
Yeah.
So couldn't I use that story, though?
Yeah.
Oh, cerebral palsy story?
Yeah, you can use that one.
And that'll like, work on them?
I guarantee it'll work.
It'll work.
Practice it in the mirror.
Yeah.
See, Donna, for men, they're looking for impairment. Men are like a lion watching a herd of antelope go by. When the one's straggling at the end, they pounce.
Yeah.
I can see the mother being impaired working equally well.
Yeah.
For a guy.
Yeah, that's good. That's good, too. But you can't seem like you can't go, oh, I'd like to strangle that bitch. Because that'll freak them out.
Yeah, that would probably
like, she's my mom. I love her.
So when a guy breaks up with a girl... And the guy starts going out to clubs. Can girls see that?
Oh, they have a meeting. They've put his picture up.
Because I think they can see that. They're like,
that one, stay
weeks,
away.
3 weeks. Yeah.
If she weeks. Doesn't want him, I don't want him either.
Yeah. He has a stink of rejection.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, that's
and,
the way it works.
And looking desperate.
Mm-hmm.
I think that's it. He sticks out.
Yeah.
Because he's just so gung-ho to, like, find somebody.
It's like, oh, my God.
Yeah, whereas as a male,
you're looking for that woman.
We love to see a woman who has been knocked down a notch. Maybe your self-esteem isn't what it could be, and it looks
target.
Like easy pickings.
Right.
Yeah, I can slide in, and normally I got to work the 6 to 7.5 range, but here's a 9 with who just recently got dumped. I might be able to slide up and get a 9 tonight. Yeah, that's the way it works. All right, because you know why? We're pragmatic as guys. That's right. We're smarter. I say it all the time, right, Drew?
You say it all the time.
All right. We'll take a little break. Donna D'Errico is here. Nikki Sixx is here. And we'll be right back.
Hello? Who's this?
This is LoveLine.
1-800-LOVE-191. LoveLine will be right back.
Hey, everybody, LoveLine. I'm Adam, Dr. Drew. Nikki Sixx, our guest tonight from Motley Crue, and Donna D'Errico, his beautiful, beautiful wife from Baywatch and BattleBots, is here. Urban Decay and JVC have gotten together and created a line of stereo units that are specifically automobile stereo units that are specifically designed for women. And those will be in the stores when? Are they there now? I haven't seen them yet.
No. You can... Actually, you can. Yes, they are.
Is there a website?
Yeah, jvc.com. You can check it out.
Yeah. And listen, we got a lot of gay listeners. You may be interested in some of this yourself. I mean, let's face it.
And, you know, the marketing campaign for these has just barely begun, and already they're on back order.
Because oh, really?
They're so huge. Huh. They haven't even promoted it, but they've been in the stores, and they've been selling out.
Well, maybe they should launch one for blacks, Asians, Iranian. I don't know. I'm just
personalized
I'm just running
goods,
here.
Wow.
Yeah. Guys over 6 foot who have fat fingers.
But the thing
stupid
with these
people put
units,
bigger knobs there. Yeah.
The thing with these units is that, like, if Nikki borrows my car or something, he wouldn't be like it doesn't look that girly.
Right.
There's just some cool colors too,
right,
that are a little less common.
Because Urban Decay, they hooked up with Urban Decay because that cosmetic line is sort of hip and
right,
funky. They have the cool names for their things, and it's not so femme and soft and fuzzy, but it's cool.
It's not Elizabeth Taylor makeup.
No.
Yeah, well, it seems to me that the sort of femininity thing has been rethunk a little bit in this country, and now it's a little more sort of, yeah, pro-athlete female femininity than it was before, and a little less taffeta and chiffon. All right, let's see if we can help a few more people and speak to Jason, who's 21. Jason?
What's up?
What's up?
I had a question for Nikki.
Here he is.
Hey.
Hey, what's up?
How you doing?
Not bad. Actually, my question was, are you guys getting back together, you and Motley Crue? In the future?
Yeah, coming to stage, blah, 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 blah. Britney, stage five, Britney, stage blah, 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 blah. All right, guys.
We've talked about possibly doing a reunion / farewell / get it together one last time and crank it up tour, but no one's committed to it yet. Possibly next year, but yeah, I wouldn't hold my breath.
How's everyone getting along?
Tommy's doing his thing, doesn't get along with the singer. Singer's doing his thing, doesn't get along with the drummer. I kind of just don't really care. And my guitar player doesn't even, like, you know, he doesn't ever leave his house, so I don't think he knows what's going on. So we're just sort of in a holding pattern. But you know what? After 21 years, it's a pretty cool thing to just be in a holding pattern right
long.
Now. Yeah, it's been a long time. And you know, I love the band, but it was feeling like the last tour we did, like, we were working just to work. We were playing the songs just to play the songs, and I think until everybody really wants to come back and make it a really cool thing, we should just take our time and do other stuff. You know?
Well, it seems to me, just as a casual observer, that Motley Crue has not gone away and probably got a little bit bigger just over the last couple of years. My girlfriend was reading the Motley Crue book and said she read it all in 3 days and couldn't put it down and was really into that. Always see some stuff pop up on a VH1 or something like that, behind the music and all that stuff. It was, I mean, would you say that Motley Crue was bigger in the year 2001 than they were in 1995?
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. That's kind of nice, right?
Yeah, I mean, it's definitely starting to settle into that, you know, the history of the band. The music is holding up. And the book had a lot to do with it, too. I mean,
yeah.
When people read the book, they got to see multi-dimensions of what the band was about, not just musically and the partying, but they got to see what people's lives were about and what drove them to get to do what they did in their lives.
Yeah, she loved it.
Yeah, it's good, and we're making it into a movie. We're working.
Oh, you are?
We're talking with Paramount right now and MTV Films and going to go actually do the big screen movie.
Interesting.
Yeah. Well, maybe
with you guys in it, or somebody playing you guys?
No, yeah. Brad Pitt will be playing me.
Okay. Yeah, and I'll be playing myself opposite Brad Pitt.
No, that's negative. Now it'll be. I'll get a new guy.
Yeah. All right, let's take one more and talk to Megan, who's 17.
You didn't know that, huh?
Yeah.
Know that
seems
now.
To be sort of universal. That yeah.
National
thing.
Radio, thank you.
Megan, 17.
Minus the beard, by the way.
Oh, yeah.
Hello?
Yeah, you're 17.
Yeah, well, can I say hi to Nikki Sixx real fast and then ask
yeah.
my question?
Go ahead.
Okay.
Hi.
Hi, I think you're awesome. Your band is great.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. And you probably think that's weird coming from a 17-year-old, but my favorite band is Aerosmith, so I guess.
Right on. Hey, mine too.
Oh, really?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yes, you did.
Yeah, they should get Aerosmith on there for a guest. But anyway, I had a question
All right.
about birth control.
Done and done.
Done and done. Go ahead.
Okay, this is for Dr. Drew, but what's better, the pill or the shot? What would you say?
The shot is more effective in preventing pregnancy. In fact, it's probably responsible for the drop in teen pregnancies we've seen in the last few years in this country. I actually, however, for patients that I'm taking care of, prefer the pill. If you know that you're the kind of person that can remember to take it.
The Depo-Provera shot?
Depo-Provera has a lot of side effects.
Yeah, I used to take it.
And it bugs people. And their sex drive goes out. They get depressed. They bleed all the time. Then they don't bleed at all. And people are not that...
A lot of complaints.
Yeah, a lot of complaints about it. It's all generally kind of mild, but it's a great contraceptive.
Okay. Yeah, because I have problems remembering to take pills. So I was thinking the shot.
Well, then do the shot. Then do the shot. There's a shot now also with estrogen in it, so sometimes can take care
What's
of some of the side
one
effects.
What's the one they were putting it under the skin? What's that?
That's the Norplant. There's a patch now, too, you can wear once a week. That, Megan, be aware of that. There's a patch now.
Yeah.
So that's another option for you.
Let me just say hi to JP, who's been on hold for 53 minutes.
Wow.
Oh, that's nothing.
That's nothing. We had some 70s and 80s up there.
Yeah, thanks, guys, for taking my call.
Good. I just wanted to talk to you before we went to commercial and
really
lost you forever.
Really,
you're 19. Your girlfriend used your brother or her brother's razor to shave?
Her gay cousin.
Her gay cousin.
Yeah, and she just found out today that her gay cousin and his boyfriend both have HIV, and they've had it for about 4 years.
Yeah.
And she found out about this today.
And how long ago was the razor used?
A week ago. A week ago, she was taking a shower. Sorry?
These are all these sort of theoretic, is it possible kind of situations. Of course, if she cut herself and he'd cut himself and, insufficient, a small enough period of time had passed that there could the virus survive. And then what do you do a week later? Are there prophylactic treatments a week after the fact? Not really.
Well, you get the AIDS test, but that's not definitive for like six months,
yeah,
right?
Yeah.
She needs to go talk to an infectious disease doctor.
What
Somebody
about
may...
the DNA AIDS test that I was using when I was doing gay porn?
Yeah, it's not a week, but you may be okay in a month or two with that one. But be that as it may, somebody may want to put her on some prophylactic treatment because it's clear that you can prevent transmission.
That means you may have it, you may not have it, but you get on this stuff.
Yeah.
That would stop you from getting
Somebody
it.
Might do that, given this story.
Yeah. But also, it's not likely
not
that
likely.
She got it this way.
I would think not.
Okay, we'll take a break. We'll be back.
Okay, so I know there's nothing wrong with me. So what's up?
So I was like you, and I used to think that these datelines were totally cheesy.
Why can't I meet anybody?
But I tried everything else and thought, what the hell? So I called the dateline and actually met a cool guy.
I called the dateline and I hooked up with some cool people.
Believe it or not, other normal people are out there looking too.
877-889-DATE.
Love Line. 1-800-LOVE-191.
Well, that's the show. I want to thank Nikki Sixx for coming in here and the beautiful Donna D'Errico for coming in here. And if you want more information about this Urban Decay JVC cross-pollinated project, you can just go on jvc.com and check into it. But do it now because these things are going fast.
Mm.
Thanks, guys. It was good to see you.
Thank you.
Good to see you again.
And we'll see you soon. Until next time, this is Adam Kroll for Dr. Drew saying... Mahalo.
This has been Loveline. The opinions expressed on this show are not necessarily those of the staff, management, sponsors, or this station.
producer for Loveline is Ann Wilkins Engel. Loveline is a presentation of Westwood One Entertainment.